Yeah. An emergent phenomenon of sort.
Subjective
Yeah.
idea.
Yeah, that's difficult to grasp, really. Yeah, I think that I mean, right now there's so many problems on the practical level just to understand how this machinery works that mostly I focus on that. I mean, when I think about what are the problems that we need to solve. Yeah, okay. So Peter Passaro, for example, is trying to tackle exactly this problem. That's good to know. Yeah. So yes, I'd like to know what you have to say, but I just want to bring up once again that I'm really interested in answering the question that Mark posed, which is how do you measure progress in this? So I'd really love it if people come up with some ideas. That you have an idea, and is yours also an idea for that? Okay, so well, okay, great. Lots of ideas. Is anybody taking notes on that? Yeah, you're kind of relaying the what we're saying here, aren't you? Yeah, so then by doing that, you're actually noting everything that they're saying. That's good. Yeah. Oh, you just give them the general gist of it. Yeah. Okay, you first, David.
So it's true, there isn't really any model based on that scale where let's explore, let's
Hmm.
or not. The third point related to that is a proposal for a measure of progress, at least should. And fortunately, it's not applicable to the past or the present. But I think at the point that we start to emulate full organisms, observe that that organism is behaving in a way that the biological version is, then you can take it.
So basically, if you get the behavior right, and then you check what is in this organism, what is it that you have set up in your emulation, then you can get some kind of a metric on that. Okay, that's. All right, and you had an idea too, Max. How do you measure how much it is an engineering problem versus a scientific problem? Yes, it definitely has an end deliverable, yeah. Kind of related to that, I just want to mention if we're trying to measure how far along are we to having a substrate independent mind, I might say something like, okay, we're all the way there if we basically have what Ken Haworth and Peter Passaro are looking for, which is a way to transfer an entire biological brain into another substrate where it functions. But if I'm Let's say I'm completely dependent on a number of augmentations, and some of them are, say, neural interfaces that I've got, and they offload some of the images that I see every day or something like that. They help me with my memory. They give me access to Google and Wikipedia right away and stuff like that. So it becomes a part of me, and I'm sort of offloading part of who I am onto that. Am I 50% of the way there, or 25% of the way, or something? This is sort of also a measure of how far you are towards being in some other kind of substrate. Not quite sure how you would measure how far you are, but it certainly does seem to indicate a type of progress that is, I think, a likely sort of progress to see, just because even when we're discussing it here as an interdisciplinary problem, we're still not automatically taking into account the whole context of what this is occurring in, which is that there's a whole other set of fields out there, like augmentation, VR, etc., that are going to make progress as well while this is going on. So clearly you're going to see a lot of interaction between these different fields and different interests, and you'll see progress that sort of walks along in a kind of Brownian motion with all these different things going on at the same time. Any more ideas there? Yes. Sorry, what is pharma? Yes. Well, yes, I was going to comment on that as well, because David said there's been a lot of progress in this because the general state in the brain, based on things like neurotransmitter levels, is something that pharma is really interested in. And the truth is, of course, that yes, pharma has worked on that, but it is still also kind of a hit and miss field, in the sense that a lot of these drugs work for some people, don't work for other people, may not work that well, have lots of side effects and things like that. So even though it's interesting to pharma, it's definitely far from solved problem or anything like that. But it's true that they are interested in that. And you had, yes. Right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Those are very relevant, very fundamental questions. But of course, if we have measures for them as well, that would be really good. If we know how far along we are to answering those questions, would be really great. Yeah. Okay. I need to do a moderator thing here, and I have to say that because of the time and because we have some other topics coming up, I'm going to ask for one more opinion or question, and then we should really move on to the next bit or session here. Yes. Yeah. Yes, it's going, yeah, that's right. Right. Yeah, I think that's very important to at least have, say, for example, a literature related with that, or media that of some kind. But not just that. I even think that projects that spawn off of the research that's been done, say something that is immediately implementable, maybe even commercial or anything like that, is also a way to bring that forward, to present what you've achieved. So I think, yeah, that's a really good point.
when developing a roadmap, breaking it, considering logistics, defining metrics, dividing it among interdisciplinary tasks, listing the unknowns, these are just create a list here and summarize. But then the concept of organizing the field, then breaking those tasks down, funding, outreach for public outreach, outreach for professional lobbying.
Have you been reading our documents? I mean, this looks exactly like the kind of thing that we've been writing down. Okay. Then we're probably in the right direction. Yeah. Okay. Good. Just a quick one. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Yeah. Yeah, I'm just going to tack something really small onto that as well, which is that, in fact, besides just looking at a partial embodiment, say, of something that is an organism, you could also look at a part of an organism.
Definitely.
Yes, that is not a whole brain emulation or whatever, but you can still look at results in a piece. Let's say the example we keep bringing up when we talk about it is the retina, because in the retina we know a lot about how it works, and we can show whether this is working the same way as a retina that has learned to, you know, distinguish between lines that go one way or go another way and give you some kind of output. So you can make something very similar and test it. Now, I really think we need to move on to the next session. Doesn't mean we can't talk about this again later and tomorrow in the context of actionables, which is more direct and practical, perhaps. But we really should move on to the next session. And I don't have the program right in front of me, but I think it's yours. Yeah. OK, then I'll take over your task.
I'm just going to move this because I just need to move my presentation to the main screen. So, yep, I do. Entry. I hope this works. Hi, people in Teleplace, can you hear me? Good.
Yes, we can.
Thanks, Julia. Okay, so Randall, do you want to give? Oh, do you want to advance the slides, or do you want me to do it? Don't advance them yet. Okay, and while I'm doing the presentation, you might want to move the chat text chat away from the main window, so the people can see. Yeah. Okay. And the other thing is this one. I have to move back. Okay. So you can see all the people actually in Teleplace at the moment. They're all there. So people in Teleplace, I was just pointing you guys out to the people here. We've got you projected up on a screen so everyone can see you. So if you type things in the text chat, people here can see it too on the main screen. So everyone's connected somehow. That's why there's lots of feedback. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about thinking about the computation of thinking, which is what we're trying to do here. So So you can go on to the next slide. Sorry, that's just my title slide. Okay, so at the moment we're in this community, we're quite focused on actually how to scan brains, and a little bit less maybe on how to actually reconstruct them once we've got all this data from scans. So I'm actually going to just put forward some ideas. I'm not going to talk about anything technical. I just want to kind of plant some ideas in people's heads and really make people think about this, because I think it's a subject that isn't touched on very, very much. Okay, can you see me on the camera, by the way? Yeah, it doesn't matter. No, on here. Yeah, okay, that's cool. Okay, so, and I've only got 10 minutes, so, okay, I have to hurry up. Right, so next slide. Okay, so let's emulate a brain. So here's a brain. Okay, click. And what we're going to do to the brain, we're going to take it, and we're going to scan. We're going to scan, and we're going to take all the structure of the brain, and click. We're going to put it into a computer. Okay, and click again. So this means that we can all like become evil cyborgs and take over the world. Okay, so anyway, you can get rid of that. Yeah, okay. So click once more. So most people think that this going between stage one and stage two is really, really hard. Click again. But I'm actually going to argue that this second one might be even more difficult, which is once we've got the data, what on earth are we going to do with it? Okay, so here's something that I think people might get slightly wrong when they think about, which is what I call the Moore's Law fallacy. And so what Ray Kurzweil says is that computational power is increasing exponentially. So once we get enough computational power to simulate every synapse in the brain, every neuron in the brain, you've gone too far. then we'll be able to simulate a brain. However, this is great news, but computational power can only help you if your algorithm actually is with it. Okay, so next slide. I should just explain what I mean by that. So some algorithms, when you try and run them on processors and things, they don't actually scale very well. So if you imagine a system of neurons connected together, and you're actually trying to emulate the entire system, then you have to somehow store the states of every single neuron in your emulation, and you somehow have to update the states of every neuron and every synapse when you're running your emulation. So you can imagine doing this on a small number of neurons to start with, and that's easy because you can keep track of all the states and all the weights between them. But when you start to scale up, you somehow have to move all those states into memory, do something with them, move them back from memory. And as you scale the system up, this actually slows down a lot. So you don't just need to think about how many states, how many bits, and how many pieces of memory you need to emulate a brain. You actually need to think about what you're doing to the information as you're trying to update the state at each point in time. Okay, so the second fallacy I'm going to talk about is this genetic one. So we can, as we know, humans can grow brains from a small amount of information. So why can't we build them? Because nature does it. It must be really simple. But some people often forget that the majority of the computational work is actually done by nature itself. So the genetic code is not a blueprint, it's more like a recipe. And the computer that's actually running this code is not the brain as it grows, it's actually the brain plus the entire of nature and the environment and the way that proteins work and the way that they fold and the way that enzymes work. And this is kind of quite often forgotten. So that's something else I just want to point out. Maybe people in this room understand this, but people we're talking to might not, so I just wanted to point that out. And just as an example, these numbers are very approximate, but I think the amount of genetic information that is used to encode the brain, to allow a brain to grow, somewhere in the region of hundreds of megabytes. Whereas the source code for Windows 7 is like 20 gigabytes or something. So that's what most people just ask, like, well, why can't you just like grow a brain easily? Yeah, exactly. Okay, so next slide. So another problem that we might have is a connectivity problem. So if you're trying to emulate a brain using a conventional processor, then this conventional processor is made up of elements which are joined in essentially what's a two-dimensional array. So conventional processors have several different layers to them, but this is not fully three-dimensional. It's kind of two-dimensional, but in layers, so I call it 2.x dimensional. So some dimension greater than two, but much less than three. However, the brain has a different dimensionality. So you might think at first that it's three-dimensional. So this is kind of an arguable point, but some people think that the brain is more two-dimensional because the actual neurons are connected in sheets and in layers. But there are also connections between these layers, but there's probably not as many connections between the layers as there are within the layers. So I'm arguing that here the brain is, again, between two and three-dimensional. But the question is 2.x dimensional compatible with 2.y dimensional? What are x and y? Are they similar enough for us to be able to emulate a brain using current hardware? So you might think, well, I can actually just reroute signals so that I map my three-dimensional structure onto a two-dimensional structure. But again, this is very hard to do and it doesn't scale very well. So the only thing I'm trying to point out here is that it might not be as easy as we think to actually start emulating brains in software with the hardware that we have at the moment. The limitation might actually be the physical hardware. Okay. So I have to talk a bit about quantum computing because it's what I do. But I'm just going to point out like maybe another fallacy that people think about quite a lot, which is, are there quantum effects going on in the brain and do we need to simulate these too? So I personally don't believe that they are, in the sense that I don't believe they're doing anything computationally useful in the sense of the algorithms that we think of humans as running. Obviously, there are quantum effects in the brain because everything can be described by quantum mechanics at some level. But I don't think that the brain is actually doing quantum computing, so to speak. However, even if it is, like people like Stuart Hameroff and Roger Penrose believe, then we have technologies that are kind of up and coming at the moment that might allow us to simulate those effects anyway. If it's not, then those technologies can also be used to help us perhaps make even better simulations of brains, or perhaps brains that don't exist at the moment in our world, i.e. operate with quantum effects, which I think is a really interesting area of research. So I see this as a win-win argument. So if anyone ever talks about quantum effects in the brain, I think, well, you can't really lose this argument. It's quite good. Okay. So what are the options we have for thinking about hardware? So click. Okay. So we can use we can use conventional hardware, but maybe arranged slightly differently. So not general purpose computing, but some special purpose co-processors, the units that exist like FPGAs. Next bit. And things that are non-CMOS in nature. So that, I'll keep going. Or we could even use exotic things like quantum computing, which are not really up to speed yet, but they might be in a few years' time. So we have to really keep an open mind about what kind of hardware we'll be using to simulate the brain. It might not be that the latest Pentium processor is the best way to do this. Okay. So I would suggest that something that would be best to simulate the brain in hardware would be something that's analog, nonlinear, and scalable, and maybe even more three-dimensional than two-dimensional. So I'd like to ask if anyone has any ideas, discussions about this, and you can advance to the next slide, which just has the conclusion. The takeaway message is that to remember that substrate is a key part of advancing substrate-independent minds, so we should think about the substrate as well as the independent and the mind. Yep, so questions. I don't know. I mean, they might be. Yeah. So yeah, both of those things apply. And also, for example, I mean, I'm not a neuroscientist, but I believe that a lot of people believe that chaotic effects play a large role in the brain, and those are something where you have nonlinear feedback. So you can see all the
Mechanisms.
people that are necessary. So. The interplay. Moment. Did anyone know
Carolyn.
who's next? I'm just going to turn. Which, sorry, which chips were those? Okay. Are those, I don't know much about this, are those being scaled at the moment, kind of, so in order for them to become big enough to do useful things with brain emulation, you would think that there'd have to be some commercial use for them to be fed back into scaling them. If it's just a research project, then there might not be enough money in to make that so. Okay, so let's emulate a brain. So here's a brain. Okay, click. And what we're
I'm
going to
not
do
sure
to
if
the
memory
brain,
is the
we're going to take
problem,
it and
but
we
I do have
somehow we're going to
paper.
scan. We're going to scan and we're going to take all the structure of the brain and click. We're going to put it into a computer. Okay, and click again. So that means
So.
that. So one point I would make about that is like, if we're trying to emulate a human brain, then we should like look very carefully at the way the brain does things. So the brain doesn't like, we can all
You
like
know,
become
take a
evil
load of data
cyborgs and
and
then take
just
it
like
out to a memory that's off brain somewhere and do
somewhere
something
else.
with it
Okay,
and
so
bust
you
it
can, yeah,
back.
click.
You can
It's
get rid of that.
actually in built into the
Okay,
structure.
so
Is everything you need?
click. So I was just wondering if there's some hardware architecture that we can come up with that does things locally, like has local memory points for every. What earth are we going to do with it? Okay, so here's something that I think. So if you kind of take that to its
People
extreme, you can imagine each
might get
node at
slightly wrong
whatever
when they level
think
you want to
about it,
go
which
down
is
to
what I call
having
the
its
Moore's Law
own
fallacy.
little
And
series
so
of
what Ray
memories.
Kurzweil says is that computational power is increasing exponentially. So
Okay.
once we
You
get
mean
enough
in general
computational power
for
to
simulating the
simulate every
brain?
synapse in the brain, every neuron in the brain, you've
Okay.
gone too far. then But
What
we'll be
about
able
an
to
element that
simulate
didn't
a
have
brain. However,
memory?
this
I
is
mean,
great
well.
news. But computational power can only help you if your algorithm actually scales with it. Okay, so next slide. So sorry, I should just explain what I mean by that. So some algorithms, when you try and run them on.
Which we know how to do. It's expensive. Can't use a normal cluster. A lot of money expensive also, a number of the different proposals for how to build it. But once you're connecting a bunch of processors, you can certainly get a problem with quality of that sound. That's why people, that's what physicists use all the time to simulate 3D physical systems.
But then, But so what I was going to say in response to that is, can you imagine this thing scaling to the size of an actual brain? I mean, it's, because it's one thing to simulate kind of a few molecules in 3D by using stacks of 2D, but when you're talking about, I don't know, a 5 nanometer by 5 nanometer resolution, it means that one 5 nanometer block has to talk to something that might be millions of blocks away. And yeah, I'm just saying because it's like an exponential thing, the difference between going from hundreds of millions to billions and then,
About 2x
Okay, well.
And heat goes up. Nature is going to come knocking on your simulation in 2 weeks. One is the speed of light, and the other is heat. So those are the things that have to scale and worry about. But on the other hand, I would point out that from a scientific point of view, you don't need actually all of these things. A lot of flexibility in terms of spreading out.
I agree, maybe not at first, but if you want your system to learn about the environment it's in, then it has to have real-time information if you want it to emulate a human, because...
Well, it depends on whether your environment is virtual.
That's true.
I was going to say something kind of slightly on the opposite side of that, which I think which is that's what we think of the two. Because we had a man that's not so great in the first century. Like a fleet ecology of how much optimization kind of savings on the kind of repair that you can stuff. Location is very, very different.
So you can see all the people at actually. Intel play moment. They're all there. I mean, my only point is it's something we might have to think about because we try and do this.
I think if you're not dealing with the same
Okay. So you can see all the people at So you can see all the people at I think you're completely correct. And that is also this whole problem of what level of detail is the computation actually being done at? Is it being done on an individual neuron level, or is it some higher level, more abstract algorithm that's actually running, and it just so happens that neurons are the way evolution has found to encode that? So this is actually a really interesting fundamental question. So it's really the dimensionality of the algorithm that matters rather than the topology. But because we don't know the answer to that question, we have to assume the worst case. So we have to assume that it's like spiking neuron models or below, perhaps, because we can't really rule anything out at this point. So in from that perspective, I think that the fact that it's encoded in a system that's connected in a three-dimensional topology is something we at least need to kind of just bear in mind, even if that doesn't turn out to be the final answer. But I mean, I think like one good way of perhaps answering this question practically is to start at a very low level and then put groups of these things together and then see if somehow there is an algorithm that group can be represented by, or a larger, you're essentially compressing the information, and then you can replace all those instances with your larger, more abstract thing, and then you keep doing that in a hierarchical way, but it's difficult. Oh, sorry. Yes.
brain science questions.
Yeah, that's another point, which is, sorry, as you increase your level of abstraction and replace things with larger and larger modules, you're then also removing degrees of freedom for what you can change in the underlying brain. So if you want to like emulate a human brain and then try tweaking it to try new experiments, then you limit the amount by which you can tweak it if you're tweaking it at one of these levels where you're representing functions by groups of things. On this? Oh, we're still here on this one, okay. Yes, yeah. Yeah, I mean, one way to proceed might be to simulate groups of things and then see if there's an efficient way of embedding those groups of things into, say, special purpose hardware units, and then you might be able to use those to speed up certain bits that you've found work well. Yes. Okay. So, well, yeah. Just of course. No. So there's two main things about this, and it's not really to do with quantum computing at all. It's more to do with actual hardware and substrates, which is what made me start thinking about this in the first place. Which is the chips that we're making are designed to run optimization problems, and they do that very well, so they're special purpose processors. And then so essentially you're building something to run one particular algorithm very well. So that's one point. And then the second point is that the chips use superconducting hardware, which is doesn't dissipate well. If you build it correctly, it doesn't dissipate any energy when it's working, or very little, orders of magnitude less than CMOS. So it really, realistically, you can actually build these things three-dimensionally, because you don't have the heating problem where you have to get rid of heat from the core of the chip. So, I mean, I think superconducting electronics is a really promising technology for whole brain emulation, but unfortunately it's just so far behind semiconductor technology at the moment. And that's not for any engineering reasons. It's just for financial reasons. I mean, governments don't pump, you know, billions into superconducting foundries, and or markets don't give you money back to put into your foundries. So.
So there seems to be like three different things about how you go from this physical capturing this physical brains to going to this conventional or conventional silicon type of software.
Okay.
That's my impression.
Yeah. I vote for superconducting electronics. Well, yeah. Again, I think it's tied into this level of it's tied into the level of detail argument, but we could like make the question more specific and say if spiking neurons is the correct level, then what is the best? Then can we do it with general purpose computing? So.
With a field that so many potential researchers, you could have many competing paths. You could lay out a roadmap that's not just like one single path,
I think because
or you could use conventional computing.
I didn't really talk about like distributed computing, but that might map better onto that. The slides. Sure. You might want to put them on this one. Yeah. Oh, that's a fancy. Okay. Thank you. I'm guessing it's the Symbio one. Yeah. Okay, it should work if I just drag it onto here. Yeah, this should work. So, drag it into Teleplace, and then should be uploading. Yeah, you can see all the people. Ooh. Can the Teleplace people still hear me? And is the yes, microphone level okay? It's not too loud. Okay.
Okay, so this is just input, it's not, alright, I got earmuffs on too, so I won't hear questions. Getting any sleep then, unless, yeah. Does he want to go first, maybe? Oh, right. Okay. Alright, I guess we're ready. Alright, so... Oh yeah, I just turned it... No, it doesn't have to be. We should put it back. Oh, there's two. Okay. There we go.
Yeah, that one's just.
All right. I see. Yeah, I got it. Okay, so my talk's a little bit different. I'm going to talk about why we should put computers into life rather than putting life into computers. everyone's talking about kind of like putting minds into computers, but I'm more interested in putting computers into life as it already exists, or at least as a potential mechanism for getting life into computers, so it might kind of go around like that. But so yeah, this is sort of my view on biology, which I think is shared probably by a few people here. Randall, we're kind of trapped in our biology. So this is the poster from Gattaca, the prisoner, his cell. Okay. Let's see, I'm trying to get this. I didn't want these covering my ears because it was hard to hear. So yeah, so next slide. Let's see. This was prepared on short notice too, so apologies if it doesn't make sense. So I'm going to talk about synthetic biology fairly generally. There we go. Okay, so what's the goal? So I guess my goal when it comes to synthetic biology and also these kind of mind-independent substrates is to prevent death and escape our inherent biological limitations. So I guess I don't know all the details about the organization that Randall's been talking about, but this is from my perspective and I think from Halcyon Molecular's perspective. So next. So I'll start by saying that life is nanotech. We just need to learn how to program it. I guess people here are probably familiar with Drexler's kind of style of nanotech about building molecular machines. But we're already made of molecular machines. There's already quite a bit of work been done for us by nature. So if we could just program life, then we would have nanotech, and we could do a lot with it. Next. So if you're gonna use life as nanotech, there's a couple of things you need to be able to do. You need to be able to. Everybody's probably heard this a lot: reading, writing, and programming. So and when I talk about reading, writing, and programming, I'm talking about DNA. Since I was already mentioned that DNA is not the whole picture, but it's kind of like if you can program the DNA, then you're also able to program the things that it produces. So whether how complicated the language actually is another question. But in order to use DNA or use life as your nanotech, you need to be able to read, write, and program. So next. Step one is reading or sequencing, and we're already making tons of progress there. The technology is developing really fast. It's one of Kurzweil's examples that he always uses about things that are going exponentially, and you can get $100 exome already. And there's still some issues with reading. There's biases. You can't read repeats a lot of the time with current technologies, and there's other types of biases in the way that nucleic acids are read. But there's tons of companies working on this, including ourselves. We think we have the best solution, but there's lots of people working on this. So I don't think there's any worry about reading being really good really soon. Next. Just to say about the benefits of sequencing. Before you even get to nanotech, there's a lot of benefits to sequencing, just in terms of the goal of preventing death. One of them is just understanding biology and making medicine more algorithmic. Like instead of going to a doctor where they have to try to remember what they learned in medical school, You would have your genome, your blood work, and a computer examine you physically, and then algorithms would look at all of the different therapies and outcomes of every patient that's ever displayed symptoms like this with a genome like yours, and then it would make a much more predictive medicine, much more information-based medicine. That's kind of a step. So next slide. So that's just sequencing. Then the other thing that you need, the second thing you need is synthesis or writing. Right now, the current state isn't so good. It's not quite like sequencing. Sequencing has been advancing really fast, exponentially. Synthesis has been advancing kind of linearly. It's kind of stagnant. Venter, some of you probably heard about Venter. Greg Venter made a synthetic organism. It was a small bacteria that pretty much did nothing. It cost him $200 million, took many years, and had a 1% error rate. So we need at least six orders of magnitude improvement if we're going to really want to do some serious synthetic biology, like programming organisms. Which brings up, highlights an opportunity. If there's anybody, I'm very interested in ideas for how we can make synthesis more effective. So there's a huge opportunity for business or just general advancement of science here. So next. And then the third thing, so if you can read and you can write, you need, what are you gonna write? So this might even be the hardest of the three problems. Probably is the hardest of the three problems, because I can think of lots of ways to write DNA that's a lot better than what we do right now. But this how do we do it right now? Typically, we use directed evolution, or we just cut and paste existing things that life already knows how to do. So we'll like cut and paste little genetic circuits that already exist and maybe tweak them a little bit, or we'll just randomly mutate them and try to select for something that's more like what we want. But that's probably not the way to like build a really complex organism, because networks and the functions that you want to be able to perform are so complex that a random process is going to take a long time to get there, and will produce something fairly messy. Whereas you might want to like actually understand in detail everything that it's doing. So how do you do this? It's complicated by another fact that if you're writing DNA programs, which are organisms. You don't get like, you can't just like compile it and run it and get, oh, there's an error message, I didn't have a colon here. Like that, this is producing an organism, and like evaluating whether or not it's actually doing what you wanted it to do is kind of a complicating factor. Like do you run mass spectrometry and figure out what are all the different metabolites that it produced? So you might want to build into your programming language like some sort of reporting mechanism so that you can understand like if what you wrote is actually doing what you wanted it to do. So that'll probably be an important part. Next slide. And programming, the nice thing is that we already do a lot of programming with DNA. You can just arrange nucleic acids to perform computation. They hybridize and dehybridize in certain ways, so you can have input sequences and output sequences, but not just sequences. Like there's, you can mix proteins into the mix and have these synthetic computers sense things that are added to their environment and then react in a specific way. So we already do sort of primitive in vitro kind of stuff like this, and one of the things like why, so programming DNA, just like to contrast that with what we do right now. What we do right now is we have these dumb drugs, which have already been mentioned. They're like these crude things. It's like you're talking about dopamine in the brain. You throw it in there, and it's a simple molecule that encodes for very little information. It has tons of side effects. It has these global systematic effects, or systemic effects rather than specific targeted effects. So if we really want to start editing and modifying biological function, you need agents that can perform computation. So that's what I think synthetic biology does. You deliver devices with intelligence, not just small molecules or even proteins. So next slide. I already discussed a little bit about what we can do already. We can do computation. There's lots of papers out there on computation with DNA sequences to solve, right now, simple problems. But in theory, much more complicated problems. You can make circuits, like people probably know, but like if you've any taken any like undergraduate biology, you know, like there's circuits that will sense glucose levels, and then there's like negative feedback loops to like release insulin or not, or absorb insulin, or absorb sugar, or release sugar. And so we've been able to like replicate these things in vitro outside of organisms, so we know a little bit about programming. And we also have, but this is mostly just talking about mixing and matching things that already exist, genes that already exist, proteins that already exist. De novo gene design and de novo protein design is quite a bit behind. It's pretty new. Next slide. But potentially, synthetic life becomes nanotechnology. You basically have. You can't really see my graphic there, but there's like a cell, and it's got like little circuits in it. But this is like your ideal drug is like actually a small cell that you put into the body, and it moves around, and so it's kind of floating around, going from cell to cell, and it's like sort of tasting what genes are being expressed around it, what proteins are kicking around, what kind of maybe nutrients are there or not there. And then based on what it's interacting with, it performs functions. So you can imagine, right now, the way that we target cancer with most drugs is to just throw in something that kills cells that are replicating, which is probably not like the ideal way to do it. A lot of cells need to be replicating for entirely healthy purposes. So you could imagine this guy in there going in and saying, "Oh, the cell's replicating. It's also non-responsive to this hormone that it should be responsive to. It's not adhering to its neighboring cells properly. Like it'll detect a bunch of different things, and only after you've met like 10 checkpoints, it's like, okay, this is definitely cancerous. I'm going to kill this cell." So it would be very specific. And this is the kind of thing that our own cells do. That's like our immune system does this. So it's obviously possible. It's just a matter of learning how to program it. And there's all kinds of other potential problems. Like some of you might be familiar with Aubrey de Grey's talks on all of the different types of damage that accumulate with aging, and these cells could just be a way of getting the damage repair mechanisms or degradation mechanisms into your body without having to do gene therapy, because our genome isn't really designed to be edited. It's much easier to design it's actually probably easier to design a new little organism than it is to try to modify our existing genomes. And we already have mitochondria in our cells, which are these sort of independent things with their own DNA. This would be kind of almost like a new organelle, but maybe it can go from cell to cell. Well, mitochondria can do that too, but anyways. Next. I think reminds me of like what we were talking about with like sort of parallel versus linear computation. And it wouldn't really be designed to be performing computation like a CPU. It would be continuously sensing its environment, and then in response to things that it interacts with, there would be just cascades of changes in hybridization or proteins binding to DNA or not binding to DNA, and all of this would be going on in parallel. So it would just have a bunch of sort of pre-programmed circuits that we put into it so that it would just input output. And how fast do these interactions occur? I would guess that it's more on the order of like it's somewhere between like 1 and 100 cycles, depending on per second, depending on the type of computation and how much diffusion has to occur, and how much like nucleotides have to associate and disassociate, and these are slow things. So it's not really fast necessarily, at least not unless we modify things considerably away from normal, the way life normally does these things. So next, so this is just a simpler version of the last slide, where it's talking about what are the components of these synthetic cells. You're gonna basically just have sensors, so it's gonna be have sensors on the outside, which could measure nucleic acids by hybridization, or it might just use antibodies or synthetic antibodies to detect other molecules other than DNA and their concentration. Then it's going to have a DNA-based logic to process this input, and then it'll respond in an appropriate way, whether it is to like release a drug, release a nutrient, release some RNA interference to change the gene expression of the cell that it happens to be in, or maybe kill the cell if it's a cancerous cell. So there would be an assortment of sort of actions it can take. Next. And then the other thing to highlight is that nature is kind of like just a template. So right now we mostly work with existing amino acids, existing proteins, existing genes, but we could use all kinds of non-standard amino acids. We could have hundreds of thousands of different amino acids if we wanted to. That's pretty easy to do. So if you want to include metals, maybe you want to make microtubules that have metal wires in them and things like that, you could do that with artificial amino acids. You could have new codon sets. So we have a particular codon set. It was kind of just stumbled upon by chance, and we know this from just looking back and comparing the different codon sets that different kingdoms have, and looking, and you can see that, you know, stop codons happen to evolve in a certain way, and it's just fairly random. But if we wanted to design our own codon set, we could, you know, have maybe longer codon length, maybe 4 bases instead of 3, so you could have more options. You could have error protection. It's kind of like a file system. And so including all kinds of things that we have in our own modern computer file systems. Next. And I thought I'd just throw this in here. Randall's mentioned that it might be really useful to have synthetic biology for understanding minds, for uploading, for intelligence enhancement. It's not something I've thought about too much. I'm mainly focused with stopping my body from aging. But certainly you could. I mean, just using synthetic biology as a tool to understand biology will be really powerful. So it's a lot easier to understand something if you can play with it and modify it and make variations of it. So if we might understand the brain better if we can engineer brains. Like somebody talked about having this neural tissue from some animal that you could take out and put onto, like, I guess, some kind of sensing grid. Most organisms aren't really designed for you to be able to do this and the neural network to survive. So maybe you'd want to modify it a little bit so it wouldn't mind that so much. So and optogenetics, obviously. I think synthetic biology is much preferable to gene therapy. It's much more controllable. So next. And a near-term application that just to highlight a particular near-term application that doesn't require completely synthesizing new cells or anything like that would just be designer immune systems. The immune system is really easy to transplant. There's huge natural variation within the human population. We could just find all of the optimal sort of sets of antibodies and make designer immune systems. Like, there's people that don't get AIDS, there's families that have no recorded cases of cancer. Just trying to mix and match all of the best from the whole world into like a designer immune system, and then include artificial antibodies that you've selected for in the lab as well. So it's a kind of a step up from vaccination, where it doesn't rely on random generation. It would be more planned. And I think there's 2 more slides. Next. Coming back to the how, as I said before, I think programming is the hardest part. So the question is, how complex is the DNA programming language? And this is kind of similar to how complex is the brain programming language. I think somebody mentioned the idea that you can't really summarize it in just the amount of megabytes that the DNA encodes to make it to seed the organism. You have to look at, like, it's the DNA is actually like this sort of record that is played by a record player, and the record player is like physics. So how much abstraction can you actually do? Like, if you want to be able to program, like write Java and have it compiled into DNA, you have to have abstraction, and how much abstraction can we actually do? I think the interesting thing, though, with going with the synthetic biology route rather than modifying our own genomes, is that we can just design a DNA programming language that is abstractable, and so not try to program in the same way that life programs, but program in a way that's preferable to us and easier for us. So you just make these synthetic organisms with a DNA programming language that you've defined, and it'd probably be a lot more like the ones that we're used to. And I already mentioned how can you close that programming loop where it's like you want to print an organism and then figure out if it actually does what you programmed it to do. I think that would be also a lot easier if you just made your own programming language rather than trying to use the standard one that already exists. Last slide. It's the one we've been playing with. All right. Just to mention that these are all things that Halcyon cares deeply about. So we're working as hard as we can to get the first step done right now. I'll be in the bar. All right.
Hi Ken, can you hear me?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Great.
Yes, we can.
A headphone, so if this starts to reverberate, I'm going to just cut off my own speaker.
I'm not convinced my... Sorry, hang on.
So is that showing up? Is that showing up? Can people hear me?
Yeah, we can. Oh, okay. Yeah, okay. So Ken, if you can turn your mic up as well, not as loud as possible, but like quite loud.
Okay. Let me try to do that.
Yeah. So we. Better and. Hey, that. Okay, hang on, Ken. We're just. Okay, so can you try saying something?
Hello, Mary had a little lamb.
Okay, could everyone hear that? Oh, hang on. Ken,
yes.
We've got.
Yes.
Yeah. We've got some portable speakers, so we're just going to plug you in. It's here at the front. Yeah, that's it. Okay.
Let's try talking again.
Yeah, could you say something
okay.
again, Kat?
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Oh, sorry. Could you say something again, Ken?
Can you hear me now?
How's that? I think that was a bit better, actually. Is there any? Could you get a little bit more volume on your end at all?
Yeah, I can. Hold on.
Okay.
How's that?
I think that's. Yep. Yeah, it's probably, it's, yeah, okay, Ben at the back can hear, so that's good. Okay, so let me just help Ken with the slides now.
So I think I can click them forward.
If you right click, okay, let me see if I can do this.
That worked, right?
Are they on the podium?
Oh, yeah, yes, they are on the podium. I figured that it was.
Okay, let me see. Oh, no, no, it's fine. Okay, let me try and do that. I thought. Which one is it?
It's Haworth.
Oh, got it. Okay. Project on main screen. Okay, I think it should be on the main screen now. But we can. Does it just say action items? Or...
Yes, it does.
Okay, then we're good.
Okay, so I'll just go ahead and I won't waste any time.
Oh, hang on.
I would propose a couple of action items that we can do right now, immediately, that will, I think, push forward a science of mind uploading. And I prefer the term mind uploading, actually.
Whoops, sorry.
So the number one... The number one need that I see for pushing forward a science of mind uploading is easy access to large volume electron microscopic imaging for neuroscientists. And the...
Where are you looking at, Randall?
Because it's not... Is my audio coming through okay?
No, you just look at the main screen, sorry. Just sorry, Ken. We're just getting your slides up.
Sorry about that.
Oh dear. Well, I'm looking at the main screen too, and it's showing something different. Yeah, but I just. That's crazy. Wow.
For me, it says action items, need number one, and one action item.
Yeah, so the people in Teleplace can see... Oh, you're looking right. That's really weird. How... That's so weird. Okay, so we'll just have to look at it on here. Yeah, sure. So let's see. That's crazy. I've never known that happened before.
Just project the view on a wall.
Is it working?
I think so.
Ken, could you say something again? Sorry.
Yeah, I'm still here.
Excellent. Okay.
Should I continue?
Oh yes, you're now augmented with external speakers.
Great. So I turned off my audio, so if something bad happens, send it to me in the text, please. Okay, so I'm going to quickly run through this. Okay, so I'm going to quickly run through this. The two main points that I'd like to talk about are that I think will push forward a science of mind uploading is to give scientists, neuroscientists, and immediate easy access to large volume electron microscopic imaging And the action item for that, at least for me, in my mind, is to start a commercial imaging services company based on the Atlan technology, or what I'm calling the Tate to SEM process right now. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. The number two need for pushing forward a science of mind uploading, I believe, is to perfect whole human brain chemical preservation, which is compatible with the EM imaging technology. And the action item that I've taken on for that is to put forward a brain preservation technology prize. So I'm going to not waste my time on this slide. I'm just going to click through it. And I'm going to say that the tape to SEM process is a very simple process. It involves modifying either creating a regular commercial ultramicrotome. Sorry, I have to go backwards now, and I don't know how to go backwards because there we go. There's a considerable delay in teleplace. So the tape to SEM process in general is a process whereby either a custom ultramicrotome or a regular ultramicrotome cuts tissue at sub 50 nanometer thickness, collects that onto a tape substrate, thousands of sections at a time, and those sections are laid out on tens of meters of tape. They are cut into little strips, put on to silicon wafers like the one that you see here. And so each one of these sections is a piece of tissue that is about 30 nanometers thick and 3 millimeters by a couple millimeters wide. So once these are on, once these pieces of tissue are laid out on silicon wafers, what we do is we image them with a scanning electron microscope, and that imaging can achieve resolutions down to about 5 nanometers, which is sufficient to trace every neuronal process in the brain. And it's also sufficient to zoom in on particular synapses and image them in great detail so that you could get, for instance, the synaptic weights. It's also somewhat compatible with immunostaining, which allows you to do molecular marking that is overlaid on top of these connectivity images. So how I see this is that this is a technology that should be in the hands of any neuroscientist that wants it. Because once neuroscientists have the ability to trace the circuitry that they've been studying for all this time, then they will be able to answer the kinds of questions that we're asking today. What does it take to simulate? What level of the detail does it take to simulate neuronal processes? And basically, this is kind of an important tool for neuroscientists to have to go on to a science of mind uploading. Is everybody still with me, by the way?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes, we are.
Thanks. So the tape to SEM process is currently working in our laboratory at Harvard, and it's regularly producing libraries of thousands of tissue sections. So we've cut things that are on the order of a cubic millimeter. However, we've had to build up considerable amount of infrastructure to deal with these large volumes. Tissue embedding protocols, automated SEM software, et cetera. And so to get this into the hands of neuroscientists, what I plan on doing is to start a commercial imaging service company that will provide all of these apps, and essentially neuroscientists will simply mail in a tissue sample, and we will perform all the embedding, sectioning, imaging, and data handling at our facility. Of course, what I need to do this is monetary resources. That is the main thing that is stopping that at this time. But because this is a list of action items that I think are crucial for science of line uploading, I think this is essentially at the top of my list at the very least. So the second thing that I am doing in terms of mind uploading technology is a brain preservation prize. And to jumpstart a science of mind uploading, the perfection of a whole brain preservation technique that is matched to the high resolution imaging techniques like the taped SEM process or some other ones that are out there right now, is needed. So current fixation and plastic embedding are limited to tissue volumes of the size of about a cubic millimeter, but these are probably relatively easy to adapt to a whole human brain at the ultrastructure level. So John Smart and I have formed a brain preservation foundation to manage a prize for the first group to rigorously demonstrate that a whole mammalian brain can be preserved at the ultrastructure level. And this is a real prize. It's currently funded at only $100,000, and the requirements of the prize probably require somebody to spend several times that in terms of research and imaging. So we're looking to increase this prize to a much higher amount. But the prize is, I think, a very important step for getting mind uploading research kickstarted, because it sets a concrete goal for what would be required to get as a first step to get a human brain into a computer. And so the rules of the prize is, as we've set out, is that a group has to show that you can preserve an entire mammalian brain at the ultrastructure level, so that any particular part of that brain can be looked at in an electron microscope and show you the types of images that I just showed you before. So you can imagine that once this prize is won, and thus proving that there is a technique of preserving human brain for long-term storage, that significant numbers of people will see such post-mortem preservation along with mind uploading as a means of cheating death. It'll be kind of staring them in the face at that point, saying, here it is, you can get your brain preserved today, here is proof of the quality, and here is the technology for actually reading off the circuits of the mind. And I think that this realization will certainly increase the interest and funding level for mind uploading experiments of all time, of all kinds. So that's all I had to say. So I'm going to switch over to questions.
Thanks, Ken. Yeah, I'll repeat the questions, probably easiest.
Since it seems to think the whole issue is the data collection issue. now where he knows exactly what level we need to see
Okay, Ken, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, but I didn't hear the question.
No, that's okay. I'll relay it to you. So the question was that the approach at the moment that you're doing is very focused on scanning and gathering the information. And we were just wondering if you could comment on how you know that you're sure that that is the right level of detail and the correct resolution in which to start at to reach this end goal.
So that's a great question. I would disagree that the approach that I am suggesting here has nothing to do with the eventual approach to mind uploading. It has to do with what neuroscientists need today to figure out how the brain works and what type of technology eventually can be used to upload the mind. So it could absolutely be used to determine that that plastic embedding and slicing and electron microscopic imaging is not sufficient. It could also be used to verify what is necessary, what the necessary resolution is to use.
Okay, does that answer the question? Okay, so the other part of the question was what algorithm would you use for state updates?
That's an interesting question. If I was given a map of neural circuitry for particular regions that I was studying, it would pretty much depend on the level of research that's already been done on that area. Personally, if we're going toward my speculations of what eventually will be necessary to upload a mind, I think that what will happen will be that the neural circuitry will be read off in terms of seeing what the attractor states of the neural networks are in the brain. So as Randall was saying earlier, that there's the brain circuitry, common neural network algorithms assume that there are dynamic attractors in the network. I think that can be read off of the neuronal connectivity, and then the dynamics of how those attractor states are interacting with each other. That's really where the computational action is occurring, and you can just simulate those without even simulating the individual neurons. That's my personal opinion, though.
So the question was, is current vitrification technology a candidate for the Brain Preservation Prize?
Absolutely.
Sorry, what was that?
The prize rules are written such that anybody that can show that you can a way to preserve a brain for 100 years that can simultaneously show that there is ultrastructure preservation, essentially all the synapses are still there and traceable, they win the prize. So vitrification is definitely on the table. Plastic embedding techniques are, even straight fixation and keeping it in liquid. If you can show that will remain stable over 100 years, then you can win the prize.
The question was, how do you test it for 100 years?
That's an excellent question. I think that the methodology of testing that depends upon the particular technology. So, for instance, a vitrified brain would have to go through an equivalent level of temperature cycling that was expected. A plastic embedded brain, we have samples from decades ago that can currently be electron microscope imaged. It's basically the onus is on the team to demonstrate an argument that it is preserved for 100 years. But the two technologies that are the main ones, which is vitrification and plastic embedding, those are there is good physical arguments that those would preserve for much much longer than 100 years.
That's how
Actually, we did some modeling of protein folding on the system, so it was very, very simple. It was actually a lattice protein, not a full 3D simulation, but it's a start. I mean, you have to start somewhere. Well, it's not as fast, but it was a small protein anyway, so. Yeah. I like your chat. Ben, that's trivial. Okay, yeah, was this a question for Ken, sorry, or? Yeah, okay. Okay, so Ken, you have a question. What is the prize for a mammal brain?
Okay, what is, I'm sorry, what is the prize amount for a mammal brain, or what is the, could you be more specific?
Okay, sorry. Sorry, I think I relayed the question slightly wrongly. It was why is the prize for a mammal brain rather than, say, a bird brain or a reptile brain?
That's a good point. The actual prize is divided into two positions. There's a prize for a mouse brain or a small mammal brain, so for instance, a rabbit or something like that, that is worth a quarter of the prize purse if it can be shown in a laboratory environment. And then there's a, to get the full prize amount, you have to do a large mammalian brain like a pig. The idea behind this is that when this prize is won, we want it to be absolutely clear that it could be applied the next day on a human being. So given that surgical procedures are tested out on animals like pigs, it's more logical to have the prize based upon an animal model that is used to develop surgical procedures for humans.
Okay, any more questions for Ken? Oh, for a mouse brain or a small mammal? Sorry, could you repeat that? Okay, so Ken, the question is, have any of the current preservation techniques been shown to work for small parts of brains? Like, so your question is, can you show a small piece works, then it would scale up to a whole brain? Okay, has anything been shown to work, a small piece, for example?
Yes, it has. The standard techniques for electron microscopy preservation in plastic can demonstrate a level of preservation on a piece of tissue that is about 200 microns thick, give or take. That level of preservation would win the prize if it was for a whole brain. Unfortunately, that level of preservation is currently not achievable in larger pieces, because a lot of the steps involve immersion fixation and getting chemicals into the tissue. The key step that is required is a really an advancement in perfusion technology. And that is not that great of a hurdle. So I anticipate if anybody really wants to win this prize, that they can actually win this prize in short order. Probably the imaging step is going to be the most onerous. The proof of it is going to be the most onerous. I should also say that that the vitrification work that has been done out of 21st Century Medicine by Gregory Fay is also probably achieving this level of ultrastructure preservation, but I haven't seen sufficient demonstration to prove that. But again, that's for small pieces of tissue.
Okay, so does anyone in Teleplace have any questions for Ken? Just out of interest? Now's your chance. No, okay, so no one's responding. Yeah. Okay, so, okay, we have one more question for Ken. Okay, so the question was, is there any way to use the fact that people might want to have their brains put in plastic, both from a point of view of potentially as an alternative to cryonics, but also as a possible way just to help the progress of science in the same way that people donate their bodies to science? And is it possible to use that fact to raise any funds or help in any way?
That is an excellent question. So actually, I think that's right on target. There are people, so I go to conferences of high throughput electron microscopy, there are hundreds of millions of dollars out there really being pumped into developing techniques for getting a connectome of a fly brain, a connectome of a mouse is something that people are seriously considering, and there are people that have seriously said that we need, as a big neuroscience project, to look for in 10 years or 15 years or something on that scale, achieving an entire connectome of a human being. And when I'm at these meetings, I and several other people always bring up, well, you know, you can't even preserve something as large as a mouse brain. Even if you could image all of these things, even if these techniques themselves were scaled up, you don't have the preservation that allows you to create a human connectome or even a mouse connectome. And so, absolutely, this is an area of technology, the area of tissue preservation on large volumes, whether for electron microscopic imaging. This is an area that has been under-researched for way, way too long, and it's one of the key stumbling blocks to all of these advanced neuroscience projects that hope to map the brain at this level. So absolutely, this should be seen as perfectly mainstream science.
Thanks, Ken. Oh, okay. Okay. Can I just tell? Yeah, do you want to? Okay, I'm just going to pass this over to Randall now so he can say a few final words. Okay.
The first thing I just wanted to mention is that I really want this to be an opportunity for us to learn something practical so that we can move forward from this first real live meeting and do something with it, you know, keep moving forward instead of just talking more about the same things over and over again. And I really like the fact that we did dig down and we tried to solve some issues, like we brought up the metrics, and we're going to dig through this log here and try to come up with exactly what are the things we learned and how do we move on from there. And tomorrow is an opportunity to speak exactly about that. What can we do next? There are some actionables that we're going to try to bring up. And Ken was actually sort of the introduction to that because he was originally scheduled to talk tomorrow, but he couldn't because he's going to be on a plane. So this means that that we've already started talking about specific implementations that we could do today, for example, because what he's doing is something that we have the technology to do right now. He's doing it right now. And that's kind of where we're going tomorrow. Thank you very much for coming here, and anyone who wants to continue talking, I mean, of course, that's possible. And I mean, we may fall over because we're very tired. We've been at the summit and all that stuff, but you can still talk to us when we're on the floor. So see you tomorrow, hopefully, all of you. Yes, and yes, Teleplace, hello everybody there. Thank you, and thanks for providing these services, by the way, Teleplace and Giulio. See you all there tomorrow.
Thank you very much for the great talks. It was very entertaining for us. You know, some of us are here in Europe and woke up in the middle of the night to listen to this. But
yes, thank you for that, Giulio. I know it was difficult.
It was definitely worth. It was definitely worth doing.
Yeah.
We look forward to that tomorrow.
Yes, yes. Sorry about the bad timing for you guys. It's just we had to make it fit with the schedule of the local workshop at the Singularity Summit here. Oh. Yes, thank you. That's fantastic.
Right. Maybe we should just all move to California.
That would be perfect, in fact. Yes, yes. Just move over here. That would solve the problem. No, no, really. We're going to have a few events that work out better for people in other places, obviously. Okay, I'm going to have to sign off Teleplay since there's obviously a lot going on right around me. So I'll say goodnight to you all in Europe and here too. Bye-bye.
Good night, bye.
I actually have to literally sign off otherwise.
I should save
this. Yeah. So what do I do here? He also agrees with
mine. I'm curious to get you to make a good friend. So I'm kind of engaged in that.